now I will move on to introducing our keynote speaker today. Loren Mayor is the president of operations at National Public Radio, fondly called NPR to us, where she leads multiple groups and drives strategy within the organization, from identifying new business opportunities to guiding NPR's work to be a best-in-class employer. I think she also runs an organization that we hear, listen to, and seek guidance from on a daily basis. Among these responsibilities that she has in her organization, Loren was responsible for overhauling NPR's newsroom after the head of their news department was accused of sexual harassment as the Me Too movement was unfolding. She also has been instrumental in NPR's hostility training to ensure that the reporter's safety is provided for them. These are two topics she'll be covering in her comments today. Loren is recognized across the public radio system for her commitment to public media and her ability to both set and execute vision, which turns aspirations into measurable outcomes. As NPR connects with millions of Americans every day through its network of more than 1,000 member stations, Loren's work is critical to our ability to receive news and to better understand the world in which we live. So, ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, please join me in welcoming Loren Mayor.
Thank you so much for that introduction and for having me here today. It's really an honor and a pleasure to get to speak to you, although nobody told me that there might be outbursts when I agreed to come, so hopefully we'll keep it calm. Well, you all know the adage, may you be blessed to live in interesting times. I would say that these times are truly interesting. Take just this week, we've had the Iowa caucuses, or not, the State of the Union, and impeachment hearings, and we're only Wednesday at noon. I think having experienced these times from my perch at NPR, I can honestly say that I have been blessed many times over. During my tenure at NPR, there have been seismic changes that have really rocked the journalism industry, the media landscape more broadly, and our cultural norms in the workplace, changes that were ushered in by the Me Too movement. And at NPR, I feel like we've been at the epicenter of these shifts. So I thought I would talk to you today about how they've converged at NPR, what we've done to respond to them, and about what I think we've learned in the process. And then we'll have plenty of time for questions. Before I begin, I thought I would just explain a little bit about NPR and how the public radio ecosystem works. So I'll start with some basics. The public broadcasting system, as we know it, was created by an act of Congress in 1967. The system is comprised of public radio and public television stations around the country that are supported in part by the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. And we have one of those stations represented here today. John Labonia is the general manager, and some of his staff are here from your local station, WLRN, and I'm so glad that they're here. Stations like WLRN support NPR, just like public television stations support PBS. And NPR itself is about to celebrate its 50th birthday. As an organization, NPR is a nonprofit that's committed to serving the public good. Our mission is to create a more informed and engaged citizenry, working in partnership with our member stations. And we do this by producing rigorous daily journalism that's local, regional, national, and international, as well as cultural programs like Wait, Wait, Don't Tell Me or the Tiny Desk concerts. As a nonprofit, we serve the public and not commercial interests. We like to cite a line that Shirley Chisholm used. She was the first African-American woman to run for president back in 1972. And she said, "We are unbought and unbossed." And that's how we think at NPR. As an industry overall, public broadcasting is deeply local. Stations around the country are grounded in their communities, and they're supported largely by those communities. And in a time of rapidly changing consumer behaviors, public radio has seen great success over the last decade. NPR, across all of our channels, reaches 120 million people a month. Our audience covers the political spectrum, and we're very proud of that. And we've been growing our journalists at the local and the national level. But there are some other things about public radio that we don't always talk about, and I thought I would mention them too because they're important for the story that I wanted to tell today. Our system has some characteristics that can be challenging, but I think that ironically they've actually been part of our power and our success, and there's three that I wanted to highlight in particular. The first is that the public radio system is complicated. Some people might use a different word, maybe unwieldy. There's no natural hierarchy in public radio. The system is made up of hundreds of radio stations, all of whom are independent nonprofit organizations with their own boards and priorities. NPR itself is a membership organization supported in part by fees from 263 member stations, while at the same time we're a national producer and distributor. Our member station general managers make up the majority of our board, which means that our customers control our governance. Just sit with that for a brief minute. So it's fair to say that our system is diffuse and very consensus-driven. There's a second thing about public radio, and that's that it's been chronically underfunded. At NPR, our newsroom is just a fraction of the size of major journalism powerhouses like the New York Times. Luckily, radio is pretty inexpensive to produce, and so we've always been able to work on shoestring budgets. And because we don't have a lot of money, we've been laser focused on our priorities and on really excelling in audio storytelling. And the third thing I just want to mention is that journalists can be skeptical and stubborn. They don't tend to love big, top-down organizational directives. They don't suffer fools. And that can make for some challenging organizational dynamics. So those are three things that sometimes can seem like liabilities, but as I'll try to explain today, I think those have actually proven to be more like our superpowers in these challenging times. So I started by saying I wanted to talk about three shifts in our society and NPR's response, and the first change I want to talk about centers on journalism. I don't believe necessarily in heightened rhetoric, but I say genuinely that I believe that journalism in America is under threat, and that the consequences of this for our democracy are dire. This is something that I feel from within the industry, but I think that the signs are apparent from the outside. And for me, I think there's three important factors at play. The first one is playing out in local communities around the country, and this is the death of the local newspaper. Since 2004, one in five local newspapers have been shuttered. That's 1,800 papers. 500 of those are in rural communities. And in other markets, papers haven't fully closed, but they've stopped publishing on a daily basis and they've reduced their coverage. And this has happened in places you might not expect, like New Orleans and Detroit and Pittsburgh, places you would think would have a daily paper. All of this has led to the rise of what is being called news deserts. These are places with limited or no access to local information. We're also seeing the demise of local ownership. Private equity firms are stepping in and buying up large news networks. Gatehouse Media's acquisition of Gannett, which owns USA Today, is a recent example of this. And these firms have stepped in because they see a market opportunity, and so they're squeezing every ounce of efficiency out of their investments. But in practice, what this efficiency means is eliminating journalists, or eliminating journalists with experience. There was a depressing article I just read recently about how the Orlando Sentinel, which is now owned by the Tribune Publishing Company, is offering buyouts for their long-tenured journalists. These are people with deep beat expertise, with contacts and relationships in their community, so that the organization can save money. These private equity firms are looking to make a profit. It's what they do. But they don't think about the civic impact of their actions. And the result of this in the aggregate is devastating. In 2019, 7,200 journalism jobs were lost. And this means that critical beats aren't being covered. David Simon, who wrote The Wire, which many of you may know, has said that now is an excellent time to be a corrupt local politician. There's literally nobody minding the store. And this is fundamentally bad for our civic life. Recent polls show that there's a lack of trust in journalism. According to a recent Gallup poll, 69% of US adults say that their trust in media has decreased in the past decade, and only 40% of people feel that the news is, quote, fully, accurately, and fairly reported. This makes it increasingly difficult for news organizations, both local and national, to fulfill their democratic responsibility of informing the public and holding government leaders accountable. The second factor that I think is driving a crisis in journalism is taking place at the national level. There is a vilification of journalists in this country. We see it in the political discourse from politicians at every level of our government. And the now common language of fake news and enemy of the people has real-world consequences. It's making it less safe to be a journalist in America than it used to be. At NPR, we've always worried about the safety of our journalists because we cover difficult places around the globe, and we have practices and protocols in place to protect them. Historically, we put all of our staff who travel on international assignments through what we call hostile environment training. It's a multi-day training to help them figure out how to navigate difficult situations. But because of the changing rhetoric and the treatment of journalists here at home, we've now started putting all of our domestic political reporters through this course. I used to worry about my people covering war zones and natural disasters, and now I worry about domestic campaign events and protest rallies. We send our journalists into dangerous places all the time. It's what they do. They want to run in. But the definition of what constitutes a danger zone today has expanded. And I have to pause here and just step back for just a second, because I started working on these remarks a couple weeks ago. And right at this part, I was adding in examples of the treatment of journalists from national news organizations like CNN. But we all know a lot can change in a couple of weeks. And less than 2 weeks ago, NPR's Mary Louise Kelly, who is the host of our show All Things Considered, had an interview with the Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo. And if you listen to NPR or you read any of the major news outlets, you may have heard how that went. After responding to questions that he didn't think she should have asked, Secretary Pompeo called Mary Louise into his private chambers, berated her, asked her to find Ukraine on a blank map, and then cursed at her. And a few days after that, the president appeared to mock this confrontation in the East Room of the White House while discussing his Mideast peace plan. Because this happened to one of our own, we have been internally shocked by this. And if you were lucky enough to know Mary Louise, you would know that you just can't find a better journalist and a better mentor anywhere, not to mention a Harvard and Cambridge educated journalist who certainly knows her way around the globe. But this kind of hostility is just pervasive. It is a tough time to be a journalist anywhere. And the third factor impacting journalism, I think, is playing out at a global scale. What we know now is that there are misinformation campaigns orchestrated at a scale that we can hardly fathom. Our social media platforms are being weaponized. Disinformation is everywhere. But most troubling, it's eroding the very sense we have of truth. I don't know if you all have heard of a journalism organization in the Philippines called Rappler. It's run by a woman named Maria Ressa. Rappler is a small digital shop that began covering the actions of President Duterte, and the government has come down very hard on the organization. Maria's received death threats. In the last year, she's been arrested twice and posted bail 8 times. And this is what she says. She says, "A lie told 1,000,000 times becomes a fact. Without facts, you can't have truth. Without truth, you can't have trust. And without all three, democracy as we know it is dead." Maria also likes to say that the Philippines' present is our future. So I think this is a warning to us, and we need to figure out how to heed it. It's hard not to be discouraged in the face of this, but here's where I think the first of public radio's challenges becomes something of a superpower. One of our greatest strengths is our network of stations. Like WLRN, they're rooted in communities around the country, and unlike commercial newspapers, their staffs have been growing. Recognizing some of these broader industry trends at NPR, we've been moving to create regional centers of excellence. In the past year, we launched a new initiative to create a strong newsroom hub in Texas that includes major public radio stations there at NPR. There was already collaboration in place between many of the stations, but we've built on it, adding additional reporting capacity, a unifying managing editor, and new technology that lets content travel seamlessly from throughout Texas to NPR. And we're in the process of launching a new hub, not too far from here, in some of the Gulf states, where access to local reporting is especially limited. We're going to be working with our stations in Alabama, Mississippi, and Louisiana to cover stories of the Gulf region and to add reporting capability and capacity to an area that's drastically underserved. These projects have been supported by generous philanthropy from individuals and institutions, and our goal is to build out these hubs around the country. We believe that these hubs will let us create deeper public service, particularly in communities with limited access to news and information. They'll add journalists who work in the places that they live. More importantly, it will add editors and specialists, which really is at the heart of what newsrooms need to function. It'll increase our ability to partner with other community groups who are close to the issues on the ground, and it will provide us with a common technology backbone so that we can share stories across the country. And at the same time, by strengthening our regional hubs, we can deploy our existing national resources to produce more unduplicated original journalism and international coverage. At home, for example, we're building out our investigative reporting team, and abroad, we're committed to making sure that global issues are covered. For example, before Mary Louise was sitting with Secretary of State in DC, she had just been in Iran. Our reporter Jason Bobian was in Australia reporting on the wildfires a few weeks ago and is now in Hong Kong reporting on the coronavirus. And our intrepid Jane Araf continues to report from Iraq. We can't get her to come home. This kind of work, it makes no economic sense. Journalists are not good profit centers. But we continue to invest because money is not the bottom line. We are local, regional, national, international, and this allows us in public radio to have both scale and trust, and that is a rare combination. So it turns out to be one of the beauties of public radio. We might be unwieldy, but you can't kill us. So that's how NPR is responding to shifts in journalism. The second shift I wanted to talk about is focused on the broader media landscape. I'm not saying anything you guys don't know, but audience expectations have changed dramatically over the last decade, and any media company that wants to remain relevant needs to adapt. From NPR's perspective, there's a number of industry transformations that we're tracking, and I'll highlight a couple of those. I'll shorthand the first as the rise of Netflix. If you use Netflix or Amazon Prime, it has changed how you think about your relationship to content. You can have whatever you want, when you want it, and it feels tailored to you. I often say that I think that Netflix knows my truest self. When it's late at night, I'm by myself, and every piece of content in the world is available to me, Netflix knows that I am gonna watch The Great British Baking Show and not a historical documentary, hands down. In this world that we now expect, it's the user that's in control. You never have to wait for the network to air the show you want. Everything now is personalized, customized, and on demand. The next industry trend is the proliferation of content companies. Today, just about anybody can make content, and some of them are. The barriers are low. You don't need to own a newspaper plant or a television network. The early digital-first startups are all grown up by themselves. Companies like Vox and Vice, Slate, and Bleacher Report reach millions of people each year. And it's easier than ever for individuals to be significant content producers themselves. Instagram influencers and YouTube stars are the major media players for a millennial generation. And the distinction between platforms has broken down. Today, if you're a print company, you don't just worry about what other print companies are doing. For example, the New York Times is now one of our major competitors in podcasting. So if you listen to The Daily and you love it, please do not tell me. The third force that we see with the power to shape media today is the rise of audio. This really is an audio renaissance. It started with the proliferation of mobile phones. I don't know what it's like when you walk down the street around here, but in DC, everybody's walking around with their earbuds in. The smartphone really let us listen everywhere. And then the next place that audio went was to the smart speaker. Today, 21% of the population owns smart speakers like Alexa or Google Home, which I'm hoping aren't in the room or I've just set them off. So hopefully they will not be listening to us. At NPR, we used to worry a lot that young people don't own radios. It's a fact if you're under 40, you don't have a radio in the house. And I used to sit in meetings with tons of executives bemoaning the fact that there were gonna be no radios. But now smart speakers are everywhere. And their adoption, I think shockingly, has grown faster than the iPhone. In just the past couple years, the number of smart speakers in the home has grown from 60 million to 118 million. And once people get one device in their home, they tend to have more. If you have one, you typically have three. The next horizon is what they call the Internet of Things. This is the ability for more devices to talk to each other and for us to talk to more devices. We're seeing early signs of this with smart refrigerators. and with Alexa in the car, and this kind of connectivity is only going to grow. So all this could be a little intimidating for a 50-year-old radio company. And in the last few years, there was some pretty negative press about NPR, about the sense that we were legacy and we were going to be left behind in this new and largely digital world. But to quote Mark Twain, reports of our death were greatly exaggerated. Once again, a historical challenge proved to be an asset. And that challenge was, counterintuitively, our lack of resources. So as the person responsible for our budget and making budget allocations, this is absolutely not my favorite challenge. But the reality is that NPR has always been scrappy. We might look like a legacy organization or a big institution, but we've never overinvested in infrastructure or overhead. We haven't been able to. We've leaned into our strength in audio, and we've developed deep expertise there. And we have amazing people who see everything as an opportunity for innovation. And as a result of this, over the last 5 years, it's been an incredibly dynamic and exciting time at NPR, as audio is being rediscovered by the masses as a hip new medium. One of the most important things we've done at NPR is to invest in podcasting, and this has been a tremendous source of creativity and audience growth for us. For those of you who might not be podcast listeners, podcasts are basically on-demand stories. They're a lot like television shows. They come in series and seasons. And the industry has exploded in the last few years. Today, there are over 750,000 podcasts out there, and the number grows every day. And about a third of the US population listens to something at least monthly. At NPR, we've really leaned into this form. We've offered many of our existing shows as podcasts, and we've developed new programs as well. Our strategy is to create content that encourages people to have a daily habit with us through their digital on-demand listening, just the way people have done on the radio. To help us with this, we've launched a series of short, daily, topic-specific shows. These include things like Up First, which publishes every day by 6 a.m. and tells you all the news you need for the day in 10 minutes, hosted by the Stars of Morning Edition. We've launched The Indicator by Planet Money, which is a brief daily insight into something around finance or business. And we've just started a new show called Shortwave, which is a daily science podcast designed to really feed your curious soul. The audience response to this has been incredibly positive. Currently, we are the leading podcast provider in the country, according to the main industry ranker, which is called Podtrac, and we've been in that spot since Podtrac launched several years ago. One of my favorite things is that everybody likes to claim they're the first. So some people say, like, we're number one in commercial podcasts, and we're number one in the end, but we are actually number one. 9 of the top 20 podcasts are produced by NPR, and that number is even bigger if you count podcasts from others in the public radio system, like WNYC in New York. And for us, podcast offers many benefits. It's a talent development tool, because part of our strategy has been to unleash from within and give people space to experiment. It's a talent retention tool. It's been an incubator for new radio shows. It's let us reach younger audience. It satisfies people's demand to have content that's personalized and available when and where they want it. And it's been a source of new revenue for us, both from philanthropy and from increased corporate sponsorship. It's really been the engine that's let us fuel our investment in deeper news coverage across the board. There are certainly bigger and better resource companies out there. There are venture-funded startups and major media companies that are looking to diversify, who are spending what at NPR we affectionately call crazy money. iHeart, for example, has invested really heavily in this space with the goal of taking the number one spot, but it hasn't worked. We keep beating them. And we're beating them. Public radio, we're not supposed to be, you know, proud like that, but we're excited about this. We're beating them because we've been able to use our scrappiness, our nimbleness, and our deep expertise in the audio space to catapult ourselves to a leadership position by truly understanding and serving the audience and not by throwing money at a problem. The third and final shift that we at NPR have been at the center of is a cultural one. In November of 2017, the first accusations about Harvey Weinstein came out, sparking the Me Too movement and ushering in an era of profound reckoning. Long-standing workplace norms were challenged, and people around the country were demanding that their organizations change. And unfortunately, this moment hit us hard at NPR. Just a few weeks after the Weinstein story came out, a report broke in the Washington Post about our head of news. We immediately let him go. And at first, I thought that was going to be the end of the situation. But it wasn't. Instead, it exposed this wellspring of difficult emotion in the company. People were upset about this person, sure, and the way that he seemed to have been given a pass, but that was really just a spark that lit this powder keg. There was just this great deal of anger and hurt, and it kind of ripped through our organization like an avalanche. And at the time, our CEO was out on medical leave, and so it fell to me to lead us in this moment. And in the beginning, I didn't really understand what was going on, and so I did the only thing I could think of, which was to listen. I literally asked people to sign up for small group sessions, called listening sessions, because apparently I have no imagination. And no more than 20 people at a time could sign up, and I just asked them to tell me what they were thinking and what they were feeling. And I did that for hours, and then for days, and then for weeks. And in these sessions, people frequently, they cried or they yelled at me, but they did share what they were feeling. And fundamentally, people felt that NPR was unfair. They felt that people with power were treated differently than people without power. And that dynamic, it can be expressed as sexual harassment, but it doesn't have to be. It can be expressed as bullying. It can be racial discrimination. And people felt all of those things. And particularly at a time when our journalists were feeling under attack from outside our organization, it felt like a betrayal to feel like you couldn't be safe in your place of work. I often think that leaders have a somewhat innate set of skills, and that if you're lucky as a leader, the tools in your toolkit match the moment. For me, I looked at my toolkit and I had two skills. They were empathy and synthesis, and they served me really well in this situation. I started by listening. And once I felt like I understood the issues, I held an all staff for our 1,000 employees. And I said that I was going to share what I'd heard, unvarnished and without trying to counter it. And then I was going to outline a path forward. I told them that it was going to be like talking about the 7 stages of grief, but without the hope. And then I talked about the anger that I heard, about the feeling of betrayal from a company that they loved, about concerns of inequity, and about the divide between the rank and file and management in a union shop. And then I laid out a plan for how to address these issues. I outlined 21 steps we were going to take, grouped into 5 categories: address the past, fix our processes, understand the facts, strengthen our culture, and rebuild our leadership team. And I put those 5 categories with the 21 subpoints on a big map, and I asked people for input. I gave them those sticky notes and people added to it. And after that, we codified what we heard into a culture improvement roadmap, and we started working on each and every item. So we did some small things, like instituting an anonymous hotline and making our anti-harassment training in person rather than on a computer. And we did some bigger things. We hired a law firm to do an investigation, not of the allegations of misconduct, but about how management had responded to them. We launched a mentorship program. We created a peer-to-peer support group, which is one of the best things I think we did. One of the things we learned in the process was that staff didn't always believe that HR would help them. They would say things like, HR works for the company, it doesn't work for me. But there were people inside the building that they did trust, and so we gave those people training, and we let them be a first point of contact. I like to say those people were something like a Sherpa, right? They would help you carry your burden through the processes of the organization if you needed help. We also did a pay equity study, we did a detailed climate survey, and we made changes to the way we use temporary employees. Because they are an especially vulnerable population, and as a 24/7 news operation, we rely quite heavily on them. Because I needed people to know that we were serious about changing, I started writing notes to the full staff every week just to share everything we were doing in real time. And I've kept it up. It's been over 2 years, and I still send a note each week. It's Thursday, so we'll see what tomorrow's note's going to be about. Thankfully, I don't have to focus on our cultural issues, but it's an opportunity for me to address in a regular and transparent way anything important that's happening at NPR. This was a really rough moment for NPR. But interestingly, and having a little bit of distance from it now, I think once again our strength in it came from a really unexpected place. And that was the nature of our journalists themselves. Journalists are tough. They are skeptical. They are trained to question authority. They are allergic to corporate speak and platitudes. And in this moment of crisis, those attributes worked in our favor. There was no way we could simply sweep anything under the rug or state some kind of pablum and assume that we would move on. Our journalists and the rest of our staff that they inspired, they held us in leadership accountable, just like they do to leaders everywhere. It was a difficult time, but I kept holding on to the fact that people were so angry because they cared. And I said frequently then, and I still feel it, that I would choose anger over apathy any day of the week. Apathetic people don't bring them their best selves to work. They don't push themselves, they don't push each other. And we need to constantly strive for excellence in a world that only gets more complex, more competitive, and more heated. As I said at the outset, these are interesting and rapidly changing times. Before our eyes, I fear we're becoming a nation bereft of journalists. Those journalists we do have are being denigrated. Indeed, the very notion of truth and fact is being called into question. I recently reread 1984, and its echoes to our current time are terrifying. It is, however, also a moment of tremendous innovation where users have access to more content, information, and entertainment than ever before. This is exciting. We have devices in our pocket that hold every song we've ever loved or could give us every piece of trivia we've ever wanted to know. And we're going to have refrigerators that talk to us soon. But it raises complicated questions, like how do you find reliable information in this world? And how do you hear anything you don't already agree with? And we're in the throes of a cultural shift. Well-established power dynamics, at least in some circles, are being called into question. And there's a demand for accountability and transparency from a rising generation. And in the midst of all this change and turmoil, I find over and over that NPR is a beacon in these stormy times. Rather than being an anachronism of another era, we may be exactly the media organization that this moment needs. I find myself frequently coming back to the original mission statement of NPR. It was written by one of our founders, a wonderful man named Bill Siemering. And Bill wrote this: NPR will serve the individual. It will promote personal growth. It will celebrate the human experience as infinitely varied rather than vacuous and banal. And it will encourage a sense of active, constructive participation in the world rather than apathetic helplessness. This is a moment when I think the pull towards apathetic helplessness is great. But active, constructive participation is possible. It's happening every day in your community, in many forums, and certainly on the air at places like WLRN and other stations nearby, like WQCS. I hope that you will listen. Because here is something that I have learned during my time at NPR. Listening changes everything. Fundamentally, at NPR, we believe listening changes the world. That's our whole business model. It's at the heart of everything we do every day. But what I've come to understand is that listening has broader benefits. It changes mind, it changes culture, it creates space for innovation and reflection, and it allows all of us to hope, to empathize, and to grow. Thank you.
Thank you, Loren. All right, last call for questions and cards, if you'll write those out and hold them up so our volunteers can pick them up. And while you're doing that, we have students today that come from our audience, and the students are here to ask questions for you. Our first students are from Glades Day School, and I'd like to ask them if they'd please stand and introduce yourself.
Good afternoon, my name is Ariel Harvey from Glades Day School, and my question for you, Ms. Mayor, is, in light of what you learned rebuilding NPR's newsroom, what aspects of the company's culture would indicate that it fosters a supportive environment for young journalists beginning their careers?
That's That's a really good question. You know, one of the things that struck me when we entered this crisis was we as an organization had a very, very clear sense of our journalistic values. There wasn't a single person in the organization who didn't know how we think about accountability and accuracy and our reporting standards, and we talk about them all the time. But it turned out that we didn't actually talk about our cultural values and our behavioral values and how you treat people in the organization. And I think that those things are really important, and they're important to talk about. It's important to treat everybody in your organization with respect. It's important to have a culture where people who have less power feel comfortable and free to speak up and say what's on their mind. And so we had wonderful, smart people who felt a sense of self and their willingness to speak, but they didn't know that it was acceptable. And we had to make that happen in the organization for us to really turn the corner.
Thank you. Thank you for the great question. And now from Pahokee High School, please.
Hello, my name is Jasmine Calderon. I am representing the Student Government Association at Pahokee High School. My question is, why has NPR decided to maintain its nonprofit status throughout the years when it could probably make more revenue if it were a for-profit organization?
That is a good question. One of the fascinating things is that the journalism industry is a tough, tough business, and what we've seen happen in the past couple of years is actually all these companies looking to public radio and NPR for our business model. I never thought this would happen, but the New York Times, with their move to a subscription service, they're following in public radio's playbook. I mean, those digital subscriptions are memberships, basically, and they're recognizing that support from the people who use your product actually is really important. I think for us, there are any number of reasons why it's critical for us to be a nonprofit, and part of it's what I alluded to up front. We are beholden to you, to the American people, and not to any corporate interest. Every decision we make is about what do people need to know, how can we better inform our citizens, not what's going to have the most clicks or what's going to make us the most money. And that has been just front and center to who we are, and I think is unchangeable.
Okay, thank you.
That was a beautiful segue to our first question from the audience. Loren, do you analyze bias from the major contributors to NPR? And do these contributors participate in editorial policy making and decisions?
So I can speak to the ways we're thinking about bias, at least within NPR, to start. I think it is really important to recognize implicit and unconscious bias. It is the air that we breathe. And so one of the things we've done in the last 2 years is really increase the amount of training we're offering. I talked a little bit about anti-harassment training, but we're implementing mandatory unconscious bias training for all of our managers. And we've actually been putting our newsroom managers through some training sessions just over the last month that's focused on implicit bias, because it can seep into your work in ways that you don't expect if you're not paying attention to it all the time. In terms of our contributors, many of them are our local stations. We have reporters around the country as well. And I think every piece that comes on our air goes through our own rigorous standards and practices filter. And so that's one of the ways that we try to manage that.
Thank you very much. I'm going to try to combine two questions for you. Could you talk a little bit about how the media outlets are trending to identify and appeal to specific groups of people or people with specific political beliefs? And then how are other outlets trying to counter being labeled fake news?
Yeah, I think this is one of the sort of most interesting and troubling things for me is this deep polarization and this notion of kind of filter bubbles. You know, if you look at what the media sources are for people who identify as Democrat and the media sources for people who identify as Republican, there's almost no overlap at this point. It's just these like two polar opposites, which is incredibly challenging. We, at NPR, we strive to go down the middle and to be sort of, to report it out on every side. And for us, a good day is when we get listener mail or letters to our public editor from folks on the left saying that we're too soft on the right, and from folks on the right saying we're too soft on the left. When that happens, we feel like maybe we're striking the right balance. But it's gotten more complicated for us in the last few years. I think there is a deeper desire to hear the opinion you agree with in your news source. And people don't, you know, when we try to bring a wider range of voices on, you know, people are very angry about it in a way that I don't think was true a few years before. To the question about fake news, I think what Maria says is true and terrifying, that a lie told 1,000 times becomes the truth. And we're seeing that, and we're seeing the fact that at some point people feel like, well, it doesn't even matter. I don't think that's true, but nothing matters. And I don't know where as a democracy we go from there. I mean, I felt like I had to reread 1984, and when, you know, 2 + 2 = 5, where do we go? You know, for us at NPR, we have tried really hard to be rigorous in reporting out the facts, in sort of giving the context to the argument. One of the great things we can do is go beyond a soundbite culture, so it's a lot harder to stay on your talking points if you're in a 7-minute interview than if you're in a 90-second interview, and I think that being able to hear directly from people themselves, both powerful newsmakers, but also just people around the country, is one way to counteract that. And we've been trying, and our local stations do an amazing job of this, at really telling the stories in the voices of people around this country so that we can hear from each other about what's really going on.
Thank you. You talked a little bit about how NPR has, from its inception, been scrappy, that there's been government funding but never enough. So what does an ultimate or an ideal funding model for NPR look like, and how much of that is government support? What are you working towards in terms of a really effective funding model?
Yeah, the question of government support is an interesting one. So the way it works is that the government supports this entity called the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. Or CPB. And CPB, by formula, gives the vast majority of its money to public television and public radio stations for their general operations. We at NPR get very, very little money directly from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting or the government. It's less than 1% of our budget. CPB's bias, really, is to support local enterprises. They're not that interested in funding us. Local stations, therefore, rely very heavily on some of that federal funding, and it's not equal around the country. So there's, you know, hundreds of stations, and for very small, very rural stations where they might be the only source of news and information, you know, sometimes the grant from CPB can be 50% of their budget. I mean, if you're serving a community, whereas people like to say there's more cows than people, you need that kind of support. In a major market like a Chicago, the portion of their budget that comes from CPB is quite small. It's a couple of percent. So at NPR, we get very little directly, but our stations pay dues to us. And some of that money comes from viewers and listeners like you, but some of it comes from the federal government. And so for us, if that money went away, it would really harm those stations and indirectly have a big impact on us. Personally, at NPR, our future state is not a heavier reliance on federal money. I don't think that is either likely or what we need as an industry. I think we need to be creative about thinking about some new opportunities to expand our content. How can we take what we do and expand it maybe into new markets? We don't do that much internationally, for example, and is there an opportunity? I think these same threats to democracy and journalists that we're seeing in this country, we're seeing around the world, and I think NPR could be a real beacon there, and that could be an opportunity. But fundamentally, we think that philanthropy is really important to the future of our system. That's, you know, small donations from people who just give to your local pledge drives, but it's also significant giving because, you know, a free press in this country, it's fundamentally not a great business model. And so it needs public support if we're going to have it, and I think it's critical for democracy.
Thank you. Ironically, during one of our previous speakers, they talked about with the death of newspapers, local newspapers, they felt as though that's going to have to be a nonprofit enterprise at the local level with private philanthropy to ensure we have local reporting. So
yeah, I mean, that's there are places like the Texas Tribune. There are different organizations that are stepping up that are following that model right now.
Okay, final question. All right. And thank you again to everyone in the audience for your very thoughtful questions. They mean a lot. Loren shared with me that she has a 13-year-old daughter and 16-year-old son. So how do they interact with NPR, and how do we make sure that young people like that stay consumers of National Public Radio, especially with their mother leading it?
Well, they don't have much choice because it's on all the time. But if you take that aside, I think there are a number of entry points for my kids, but for the next generation in general. One of the main ones is the Tiny Desk concerts. If you haven't ever seen one, go to YouTube, type in Tiny Desk NPR. We do a series of concerts. We invite people, sometimes you've never heard of them, sometimes you have, and our head of music is a guy named Bob Boylan. He has a little desk, and we invite musicians to come and play three songs at Bob's desk. Which they do, we record it, and then we offer it on YouTube. We reach millions of people every week with this. We reach a young and very diverse audience. We have a new CEO at NPR, and he told this story that when he got the job, he told his 18-year-old son, and his son was like, "Dad, you're gonna work for Tiny Desk?" He's like, I had total credibility. So we do have some products that are real gateways in. I also think that podcasting is really an incredibly powerful form. You know, it's in your ears, it goes with you, it's on demand, and the audience for that is a much younger audience. And once you start listening, you listen a lot. And then finally, I do think that historically, one of the ways that people find NPR is through a trusted guide. Maybe that's a parent, maybe that's a teacher, maybe that's a friend when you get to college. That a lot of people, when they're sort of entering that college moment and they want to feel like an adult, they want to feel responsible, NPR becomes a signifier of that. That is a way of demonstrating that you are a grown-up in the world and that you care about what's going on. And I see that still continuing. I think that, and it's even going down. I mean, my daughter gets assignments where they're asked to look at the news for their school projects, and NPR is frequently pointed to in the classroom. So I think all of those are ways where we are going to continue to be important to a new generation.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I can tell you personally, you are a trusted guide. I hope all of you have enjoyed today's program as much as I have. It really was enlightening and informative. Remember, March 16th, you'll get an email tomorrow. Please sign up. Travel safe and have a great Valentine's Day. Take care.